ni koromanya ade marini silamanu ambaka kumara none fanya numa befonyo nomano ni koromanya ade marini silamanu ambaka kumara none fanya numa befonyo
aywa anla me bau au kadron kuma chaira bayle machu funga kosobe kabinu ukolokolo yoro fokase.
Good morning, dear radio listeners. Today your program has to do with a subject that you are not familiar with. We'll be talking about Bayera Machi, the transformed nourishing mother, what Europeans call genetically modified organisms, GMOs. GMO means new seeds. It's composed of different genes that are not of the same species. For example, you take a fish gene, put it in a tomato, and create a new seed. That's what we call Bayera Machi. Scientists discovered this new seed. What is the Bayera Machi? How was it developed? How is it useful for growers? What are its drawbacks? That's what we are going to talk about in today's radio program.
I am a farmer. I do mixed farming. I produce cotton, corn and meal. I've got 50 hectares, 3 tractors. Here in Mali, I'm considered a big grower. I've always worked. My children have always worked. And my grandchildren will do the same. Given the pace the world is going, I'm afraid that their life will not be the same as mine, a life caught between seed producers and African politicians.
Africa is confronted with all sorts of problems: demographic problems, political, economical, ecological, and food problems. Today, international experts say that genetically modified organisms will pull Africa out of its food dependency. But what is a GMO? In order to answer this question, men, women, non-governmental organizations, and various institutions have pulled their resources together to organize a citizen space for democratic deliberation on GMOs and farming in Mali, the ECID, in Sikasso in January 2006. The subject of this citizens' jury is GMOs and the future of agriculture in Mali, one of the major producers of cotton in West Africa. The citizens' jury is an information space, a place to exchange, debate, and dialogue. The goal of the citizens' jury is to allow cotton growers to better understand what GMOs are. To reach this goal, experts in the field confront their opinions, and those with first-hand experience are asked to explain their positions in favor of or opposed to GMOs. The group is expected to make recommendations concerning action to be taken. 45 participants have come here from the Sikasso region. Clear criteria have been defined in a fully transparent way so that the farmers and growers participating in the ECID truly represent the diversity of farmers throughout the Sikasso region.
We don't know what GMOs are. We don't know if it's a good or a bad thing for us. If somebody comes and helps us understand what a GMO is, that is a good thing. We need to know what it is before we can decide if we are for or against it. Sikasso is a cotton town, and we are going to find out whether GMOs help us to increase production or not. Cotton is our only livelihood.
This isn't a space where you come and tell people what to think, what position to take. It's a space where you come to inform people so that they can realistically size up the issues.
Farmers are people who are very careful about what they say. They have got a lot of experience. They know how to listen. And we think the farmers who have come here will be able to sort out information and understand what we are talking about. We must not forget that our farmers have an oral tradition, so they know how to decode the spoken word.
Everything that you build for us as growers and that you build without us as growers is not useful for us. I would like to draw to the attention of the farmers' organizations that each participant here expresses his ideas freely.
I think the key moment in the birth of this process was during a workshop at the Regional Assembly in Sikasso. During the two-day workshop, the idea of forming the ECID was developed. We had previously discussed it at the Regional Assembly, where there was a lot of concern about GMOs. The Assembly wanted there to be a debate on the question in the Sikasso region. The debate needed to really reach farmers in the area so they could weigh the issues of this important question in Malian society.
It was important for us to advertise this event all over the region, before it even began. We chose one radio per circle. So for seven circles in the Sikasso region, there are seven radios. The role of each radio was to broadcast the entire citizens' jury process and its outcomes. There were activities going on at each circle, and an information strategy was set up to allow each participant to understand all the issues at stake here.
Dear participants, if given the importance of issues revolving around GMOs, I encourage each and every one of you to participate openly and non-emotionally in this debate. That being said, I declare the task of the citizen space for democratic deliberations on GMOs and farming in Mali to be underway. Thank you.
So when you go buy the seed from your pocket where it costs so much, so that you don't buy that cheap, that expensive one, you buy the cheap one. But on the harvest day, when you sell, well, you'll pity yourself that hey, if I had money, I would buy this one, which will give me more. Before, we used to sit down and say, well, we make so much money, and then where will we get money to pay that and that and that? But with this late state, we used to sit down and say, what are we going to do with the extras that we've made?
I would like to pose three questions. Question one, you say that when you planted GMO cotton, it rained for 3 months, but you didn't say what would have happened if it hadn't rained? Question two. The people who sell you the seed are the same people who buy your crop? Question three. Which variety of cotton is preferred by the buyers?
I think the BT is just the same on drought resistance with the non-BT. The only difference is that when it is attacked by ball waves. So there's no difference in water and so on. Don't take what I said to you. Don't take what I'm telling you. Find out if it's good for you. Because I'm going home, I'll be eating, dining, and making a lot of money. And you'll be starving, pushing that seed that is not capable of bringing money into your pocket. Thank you.
One day that the gentleman came from seed company and come and introduced to us the new cultivar called BT. I took it and planted, and I found it very much good for me. It helped me. It was better than the cotton I used to plant for BT, because of the subsidy from the government, that the government is giving us the money. Because it's a little bit expensive, the BT, than the conventional.
How much? Three times more.
Uh-huh. 3 times more.
My dear friend Buthelezi said that if you don't take risk, you will have no story to tell. But I have a story to tell, which is not the same story of happiness that Mr. Buthelezi said. This is a story of farmers who took risk and in the process paid with their own lives. Frustration with the pest problem in their cotton, they decided to experiment with BT cotton now. They are all rain-fed farmers. They have no irrigation. Therefore, to see how their soils will react to BT cotton, we filmed them all through the 3 years from 2002 to 2005. So, in the first 3 months, their BT cotton was very good. But then, after that, it started completely collapsing. The farmers were enraged. They went and burnt up Monsanto seed depots. They held marches in town. They blocked the roads. And they forced the government to act. People had thought that our own scientists will do justice to us. But our scientists got bribes from Monsanto and gave fudged reports, and therefore some of them were dismissed from the service also. So after these 3 years of bad performance and a lot of media hue and cry, government banned Monsanto seeds.
Aithe raithulakunna telvi aalochana anta adi pakkaku teespettinru teespetti ippudu allu em paniki raanulla leka allu baanisalai batukutunnaru annamata.
So I can tell you the such number of stories of women and farmers. What I feel is farmers have sold their own knowledge to the others, and they have preferred to live like slaves for the big companies. This is the story we have seen in. In the district of Warangal itself, about 130 goats died because they ate the BT cotton refuse. This year itself, in a province called Vidarbha, of 200 farmers who committed suicide, 172 farmers had grown BT cotton. 172 farmers committed suicide because they had grown BT cotton.
According to the people who sold you the seeds, you are supposed to be able to produce 4 tons per hectare. That's over 1.5 ton per acre. But in fact, you only produced 1 ton. Can you take them to court?
Already happened. We are not taking the Monsanto to the court. It is the government itself which has taken Monsanto to the court. Firstly, the government banned all Monsanto BT seeds. And then it asked Monsanto to pay farmers 2.5 billion rupees as compensation. And when Monsanto tried to go to court against this order, Andhra Pradesh government asked Monsanto to completely get out of Andhra Pradesh, shut all of its offices, not only BT cotton, but you can't sell any of your products in Andhra Pradesh. So you have the tragic story of India in front of you. We all know fire burns. I don't go put my hand in fire to find out whether I can take the risk of getting burnt by the fire. Please don't take that risk. Enhance the quality of your cotton. Be the kind of farmers that you are. Salute. For me, genetic engineering has not come to help farmers. Genetic engineering has come to completely occupy what farmers' knowledge used to be, what farmers' control used to be. It is an issue of autonomy, it is an issue of control for the farmers. It's an issue of diverse cropping systems, it's an issue of diverse seeds.
In terms of methodology, I think that everything has gone well. This morning there was a farmer in favor of GMOs and he was pleased with what their South African speaker had to say. During that break, lots of farmers were leaning in the same direction as him. They were more or less convinced. But during the afternoon, the Indian speaker was totally against GMOs, and this created some doubt in farmers' minds. In any case, I think the goal of this conference has been reached, the goal being an exchange of opinions for and against GMOs.
Today, it's not easy to sell our entire harvest. If we produce GMO cotton tomorrow and increase our yield, who are we going to sell it to? That's the question I asked Mr. Boutelisi. All he could tell me was he earned a lot more money with GMO cotton than with conventional cotton. Are you satisfied with that reply? Yes, I'm pleased if another grower like me says he makes good profits by using GMOs. I'm happy for him. But what he doesn't realize is that I can't ignore the consequences of GMOs on the soil or on the environment. I'm not merely looking for money. I'm also seeking good health for my family, for my countrymen, and for everybody in the world.
Moi, je vais vous parler des risques et les risques avec les OGM. Quand on a donc une...
I'm going to talk to you about risks. As far as GMOs are concerned, if you take a genetically modified plant, it's important to observe it in different ecosystems to see if its behavior is abnormal. Here, if you can make it out, you see a genetically modified potato which appeared perfectly normal in a greenhouse. But there was a cold spell. And after that, we observed that the same plant made its tubers in the air instead of in the earth. The following year was very dry, and we observed that the genetically modified plant was much, much smaller than the original.
Here is my question. You do research on genetically modified potatoes. If I buy your potato seeds, will I be able to produce my own seeds from the GMO potatoes I harvest?
That's a very touchy question. I'd like to begin by saying that we only do scientific research. In general, what is commercialized are the crop varieties that come from the Monsantos, which you have heard a lot about. As far as these commercial varieties are concerned, the farmer is not allowed to keep the seeds he produces or to use them again. He has to buy new seeds every year. That's the economic risk of having patents on seeds.
When people first started talking about GMOs in Burkina Faso, there were two tendencies. One group said, it's marvelous, it's a new technology, it's an opportunity for Burkina. They said we were behind in terms of technology, and they set up a pro-GMO organization. The other group started out by saying, hey, do you know what that means in Africa? It means better wait and see exactly what it is. Because the people who are behind GMOs are business people. Whether they are Americans, Canadians, Burkinabe or Malians, they're all the same. They all have something they want to sell. Just because a technology is state of the art doesn't mean you have to adopt it. Technology has to correspond to social reality, cultural reality, economic reality. It has to be in accordance with the politics of the country or community. Whether it takes 10, 20, or 50 years or more to do the safety tests, it doesn't matter. It's necessary because man's health is at stake. I would like to remind you of a similar situation, the mad cow disease. You have no doubt heard about it. Europeans had invented a technique that consisted of putting meat into cattle feed, whereas everybody knows that cows eat grass. They put meat in the feed and people said, hey, be careful. We were told, no, it's all right. Cattle are feeding. That's what matters. The cattle ate and ate. They got fatter. They produced milk. 16 years later, the first signs of the disease began to show up. And how did those people react? They slaughtered herd after herd. If one single steer showed signs of the disease, they slaughtered the entire herd. They killed thousands of animals. The question is, if a similar situation happens in Burkina Faso or Mali, would we be capable of slaughtering all those animals without creating a new crisis? What I'm saying is, the famine problem is linked with politics.
We are women growers, and we are afraid of GMOs. After harvesting conventional cotton, some farmers grow rice in the same field. Others grow potatoes in the same field, and so on. If we switch to GMO cotton, will we be able to do continue farming this way?
An experiment needs to be done because, as I mentioned, there's an abundant secretion of toxin in the soil. How is this toxin, this poison, going to affect other crops is a question that needs to be studied.
At our place, we have bees that produce honey that we eat. Will we be able to consume that honey without putting our health in danger?
That's a pertinent question. We are going to see problems concerning bees. Will bees even be able to survive in the next 10 years and continue making honey? This is the kind of fundamental question we are faced with.
In Burkina Faso, we were producing more than 200,000 tons of cotton. And today, the level of production is more than 700,000 tons without the use of GMOs. People think that GMOs are the reason for the high levels of cotton production in Burkina Faso. But it is not true.
We grow food products such as sweet potatoes and yams. Are there GMOs for these crops?
When it comes to small-scale local production of food crops, which exists in Mali and many other countries, companies are not interested in these products. There's no major economic stake for them. As far as multinationals are concerned, they will get involved in food production only if the product is widely bought by a large number of consumers. Today, cotton is a crop that's economically exciting. Multinationals are willing to get involved with cotton because they know that once the product is obtained, they'll be able to sell it for a profit. If they work on potatoes, they'll only be able to sell the product in Mali and neighboring countries. There's a limit to what they can gain. This is an important point to consider concerning GMOs. There's a fundamental element, in my opinion, that's being ignored today, and that's the socio-cultural dimensions. Seeds and grains are part of our country's culture. They participate in a process of social reproduction. For us, they are property that belongs to a community. For years, communities have been keeping seeds alive. Now here comes someone. He does some research on the same product that people have been preserving for years, and suddenly it becomes individually owned property. We have a notion of collective ownership over seeds instead. You see how extremely important it is, because it's destructuring the very idea of ownership, the we or the you. The we is transformed into a we and they.
I would like to begin by saying what GMOs are. For us, GMOs are cause for worry because we were brutally confronted with the problem, whereas we had thought it didn't concern us. We grow food products essentially in order to feed our families. We don't grow products only for the market. That's not our goal. Producing food doesn't mean we're against progress. On the contrary, we like tractors, fertilizers, new seeds, but we don't want to become slaves. We produce cotton for fertilizer, and we use part of the fertilizer to produce corn that we eat. So, what reason have we got for buying seeds that we're not sure of being able to develop? Because we wouldn't be able to use the needed amount of fertilizer. For us, it's a matter of choice between different models of development. It's an aberration to say that this can be a good thing for us.
Here in Mali, there is a group of researchers. There are researchers who are here for agricultural varieties and they work. And it just so happens that some of them have taken position in favor of GMOs. So who are they working for? For their own pockets or for the good of the state?
We can't do research without financing. Our country doesn't have the money to do the research, so the financing comes from abroad. So if research is financed outside of Mali, doesn't that squeeze us into a corner? When we experiment with cotton, the cotton belongs to and is financed by Monsanto. How can we say that the work we're doing is not good? I see this as very, very difficult.
My question is about GMOs. Our godparents produced, we produce. Nobody ever talked about GMOs before. Now everybody's talking about them. How are we going to feed our families tomorrow?
Mr. Sangare raised the question of GMOs and of our food self-sufficiency. I would like to address this question. Even today, the multinationals and all the people promoting GMOs no longer dare to say that the purpose is to fight hunger. They know that it's wrong to say that. We're not financially independent, yet we seem to think we need to go looking for resources elsewhere. And these resources come with orders and strings attached, with politics, with conditions, all of which means we have no freedom. Why do you find so much bread in the marketplaces today, whereas we no longer eat millet cakes? We have simply lost our freedom. If you want to export cereals to France, for 1 kilo of wheat, you have to pay 90% in tax. If you want to export 1 kilo of rice, you have to pay 97% in tax. But if you want to import 1 kilo of wheat or 1 kilo of rice, you pay 5% in tax. The questions that farmers ask today show that they have begun to understand the issues and the fundamental questions concerning GMOs. It's a question of manipulation. Very simply, we're not doing research. When researchers say, we don't take positions, we only do research to discover, I want to say to them, but whose money are you working with? They're working with financing by multinationals. Why don't they just say so, loud and clear? I think it's right that people know that researchers are working with money from Monsanto, Syngenta, and other agricultural multinationals supported by the American government. Researchers should tell us, but they don't. A researcher will say, I don't know where the money is coming from. Some of it's coming from my field, but mostly it's coming from the government. He says, I do my research, I try to find out something and give my results. I don't take decisions. The government takes decisions. But when GMOs start killing people, who's going to be held responsible? The researcher will say, all I did was show the results. I didn't know what the effects on the soil would be or what the effects on human life would be. The government's responsible, and the government will say the researcher is responsible. So who's going to be held accountable? I say this is a question of social responsibility. Each one of us should define his position as an individual and as a citizen.
The Sikasso Radio suggested doing a live broadcast of the entire ECID. But since the towns we come from are too far away to pick up a live broadcast, we said we can broadcast the same debates but pre-recorded. Each day we record the debates here in Sikasso and send them out on tape or some other form, so that people everywhere can hear the content of the debate with no alterations. The purpose of the forum here is to allow users, farmers and growers to form an opinion on GMOs. Every evening, we do a wrap-up of all the activities of the day, of all the debates. The other radios synchronize the broadcast for the population of the Kajola Circle, including neighboring countries such as Ivory Coast and Burkina Faso, so that they have the same information at the same time.
The behavior of BT cotton is not the same from one country to another. That's why each country should try to find out local conditions, the advantages it may obtain in context. What seems to be general true is that given the reduced number of treatments, BT cotton farmers are using less insecticide. Therefore, we have a beneficial effects in terms of environmental protection. For small farmers, a price has been negotiated that will allow them across technology. For industrial-sized farmers, those who exploit 1,000 or 2,000 acres or even more, the price for planting an acre is not the same. It can be twice as much. What this means is that once we have carried out experiments with BT cotton, once we have determined its advantages, we will evaluate the profit margins we're going to obtain. Then there's a negotiation with the farmers by which we'll share the profits.
It has been shown here by four participants that BT cotton has detrimental behavior. However, for the current participant, a BT crop has advantages. What are those advantages? Why don't Malian researchers have all the same opinion? Are they for or against GMOs?
Well, which side did he put me on? Since there are two sides indeed, I've been careful, and I will repeat that as researchers, we do not take sides in the GMO debate. I can have no position for or against BT cotton if I haven't studied it. Evaluations have to be done.
Il faut faire des évaluations cas par cas.
We have worked on that question. Here I am presenting the results. But if someone else comes and says they have found results elsewhere, that means they have done research too. We have to do research in our context. This is the field. Here you have non-BT cotton, and further down is the BT cotton covered with a cloth. There's a 2-meter aisle between them and surrounding the fields. Where the cotton is ripe, here's how it burned. A sworn legal expert is there, and he writes up an official report. He has to prove that no part of the BT plant escaped, because there's the problem of persistence. That's important because it's a research station, so it's guarded day and night. It's burnt so that a certified analysis can be done by a sworn legal expert.
I'm worried about traditional cotton and non-BT cotton that I have. After the analysis, you burn what's left. Why do you burn it?
It's a precaution. We're doing research. On top of our research, we don't want someone to take a cotton seed and go away somewhere else with it. It's not a question of hiding information. It's to avoid that kind of thing happening. There are guards day and night. All it takes is someone coming, taking a seed. You know how many capsules there are on the cotton plant. Then we do our study. But it has to be done within the limits of the research stations.
In your research, do you ever worry about the question of human health? What about soil, wastewater, toxins, and everything that has an effect on human health? Because the earth is where populations live. It's our wealth, our only asset. So I would like to be enlightened on the subject.
I think that's really important. We didn't even wait for BT cotton to do it, because when you look at the first generation of insecticides that were used for a long time, there are areas where insecticides are still stored even today. You have water that's polluted. You have a very long persistence. But today, thanks to research, the persistence of studied products has been reduced to 2 weeks at the most. And we are currently working on new chemical products to reduce persistence time.
I work in agricultural biology. I don't use weed killers and I don't use insecticides on my plants. In 1983, only 3 grape growers had more than 15 hectares. Today, there are 15 grape growers remaining, and each one has between 20 and 50 hectares. Cotton worldwide is the agricultural product that uses the greatest amount of insecticides and pesticides. In Europe, there's a tremendous market for non-GMO cotton. If you want to give it some thought, you could get organized and go towards this market with a non-GMO label. Farmers from Confédération Paysanne are prepared to sit down and think with you about it. I would like to end by saying that more and more researchers in France are working with farmers in the fields, selecting with them in the fields and not in the laboratory.
Before GMOs were produced in France, were French farmers alerted by the government? Or was the government not informed that GMOs were going to be introduced? I am following the example of this forum here. Was there a forum like this in France? that warned farmers that GMOs were coming?
Thanks to Via Campesina, which is a worldwide farmers' organization, we were alerted. The government in France didn't want a debate to take place on GMOs. That's why we cut down GMO crops in the fields, to force a debate to happen.
The goal of this forum is to really create a safe space for people to understand the issue around GMOs and for them to give their opinions on the question, has it gone well? As observers, we must decide if this has been a fair and transparent process.
Après quelques 20 à 25 minutes de cuisson, ça devient du beurre de karité.
The evaluation of BT cotton caused public indignation, and we think that is it should be. But here, where we are just now, I ask you, go to the shops, look at the oils and other products sold in supermarkets. See if you can find GMO oils there. In Burkina, we have decided to use only varieties from Burkina in order to transform them, and that's why we have sent our researchers to the United States with these varieties, and they have begun the transformations. They are at level 5. The colleague has transferred these varieties from the United States to South Africa in order to continue the job on account of Hurricane Katrina. At this point in time, Burkina hasn't made any decision whatsoever to introduce or develop the BT cotton production.
Today, there are other elements coming into the production chain. That is to say, GMOs. Apparently, the toxin content in that plant has a limited duration, and the toxin loses its potency at some point before the end of that duration. Have you, as a researcher, tried to see if the toxin causes any problems during the duration that has been defined? If there are problems, can we take GMO producers to court?
I can say that the persistence of insecticide efficiency, the efficiency of a toxin, is not due to acids. If you expose a living being to the same toxin for a long time, the person becomes insensitive. He for sure will develop a resistance. It seems to me that our grandparents, those who were warriors, got accustomed to poisons so that their enemies could not poison them.
En 1995, eh bien, le code génétique du riz sauvage a été séquencé et breveté.
In 1995, the genetic code of wild rice was sequenced and patented. In other words, the properties of most of the genes of that rice were identified and patents were registered on those genes. That's how a gene from our rice was named XA21 from our African rice, that we call Oryza longistaminata. An American university identified this chain resistant to bacterial blight, so they manufactured another transgenic rice and registered a patent. The state of Mali is a participant of signatory at the Convention on Biological Diversity. The third objective of the convention said that we must foresee mechanisms for fair and equitable sharing of profits resulting from the exploitation of biological resources. But when the patent was registered, nobody negotiated with the Malian people who cultivated the rice to begin with and who preserved it for centuries, for thousands of years. There were no negotiations with the state of Mali concerning the creation of mechanisms for sharing the profits. So that's a concrete case of piracy of our African genetic resources. The fundamental question is whether it's acceptable to patent living things. Does an individual or a firm have the right to say that because they worked on improving a variety or on obtaining a plant variety, they are the owners, even though the basic material they used is the property of the local communities? That's the fundamental debate. They're not recognizing the rights of farmers and local communities. They're recognizing the rights of multinationals through the patenting of living organisms. From an ethical point of view, the first intervention this morning showed that there is an ethical problem. I won't make any comments.
I would like to ask you a question. Is cotton BT cultivated in your country?
GMOs are not currently being cultivated in Benin. Why? Because we in Benin are doing the same work that we are doing here. With our government, we worked in 2000 and 2001 and in March of 2002. The Beninese government decided on a moratorium. The moratorium said that transporting, bringing in or commercialization GMOs is forbidden in Benin for 5 years until March 2007. At this very moment, whereas the moratorium is still in effect, the same government is bringing into Benin food aid from the United States with the backing of USAID and of the Catholic Relief Service. That's the reality in the field.
They extracted genes from our country and they used them. Is it possible to get property rights back?
Yes, we can recover property, but there will be a legal battle, because another person has registered a patent on the rice in which your rice gene was inserted. When someone registers a patent, that means that the property belongs to the person who registered the patent. Now, if you judge that the gene came from your country, and if you want to retrieve it, you're going to go to court. It has already happened in India with basmati rice. A patent was registered on it, and the Indians went to court to get it back. I haven't followed up on that story, but yes.
When a convivial space is created, like the one here this week, you can see that in this context, when facing experts who give contradictory opinions, farmers are entirely capable of understanding and analyzing complex situations. We have the knowledge of the experts, which is either reductionist or sectoral, and we have the experiential knowledge of the farmers that comes from knowing their livelihoods. The confrontation of these different forms of knowledge in a forum such as this one helps to balance the power relations. Very, very often, experts leave this sort of gathering saying, I learned a lot of things that I didn't know before.
Every day, we do news reports, interviews, and commentaries on the subject, and we send them out. We've already had some feedback, and people are pleased. The ECID on genetically modified organisms and on the future of agriculture in Mali which opened last Wednesday at Achas Luanga Center in Sikasso, is drawing to a close. There is no way around it. Genetic modification is a new science today, and our country must not remain on the sidelines of evolution. But the last word belongs to farmers. Rendezvous tomorrow to listen to the growers' verdict.
We have to write that GMOs destroy the environment, human relations, and health. I would like to add that if people say GMOs increase production, whereas we are not able to sell the conventional cotton we produce, in my opinion, this weakens us. If the government makes us produce GMOs, why should not we rise up against this decision? If we don't fight now, what is our children's future going to be? We are sewing a slave's garment and putting it around our children's necks.
I am going to read to you what we have written. It destroys the environment. It makes growers dependent. We will have to buy our seeds every year. We can reproduce seeds from our own cultures.
We should write that GMOs transform our ancient varieties. We ask the government to tell the growers to not cultivate GMOs or we'll burn their fields.
Growers and political authorities must not allow GMOs in this country.
We have plants that we use to feed ourselves, to cure illness. GMOs can contaminate these plants. We have to write that down. This will make us dependent on foreign countries. This will provoke despair. A man with no hope is a lost man.
So, if there is no humanity, it's the end of mutual aid. No more compassion.
Farmers domesticated food cultures. Farmers exchange seeds without paying money. When I have an interesting variety, I give it to you. I give it to my farmer brother. Now with GMOs, they come and take the gene from my variety. They transform it. They come back and sell it to me. And I can even be brought to court because my field has been contaminated. It is the end of the world. I note the following item. Our Asian varieties don't cause illnesses. If we adopt GMOs, what are we going to keep for our children tomorrow?
I think we have said a lot of things, and we should note it all for tomorrow.
We are going to present what we gathered from experts' testimony here. They didn't come to tell us to accept GMOs, not to tell us to reject them. As far as we are concerned, we decided to conserve local seeds so that they don't disappear. We decided to orientate research towards local seeds too. It's important to improve things on local level. The refusal by authorities to bring BT seeds to Mali, that's a respectful thing. We never want to have BT seeds. Therefore, yes to traditional seeds, no to GMOs.
No aux OGM.
Here in Mali, economic considerations are very important. Growers would like to remain masters of their seeds, masters of their soil, masters of their lives. Several times we have heard, we don't want to become slaves of large firms or of seed merchants. It's true that we don't hear this kind of reaction very often in our part of the world, because in our countries, it's the consumers who lead the debate. I think it's very positive to give a large role to women in this ECID. It's often said that the future of Africa is in women's hands, and I have noticed that this has proved to be true time and time again.
The question is not whether one is for or against GMOs. The question is above all to understand what kind of society is behind GMOs, what's at stake for farmers. If we look 10, 15 or 20 years into the future, what does it mean for us to make a choice today? Now, I think this democratic debate is also useful for policy making, because politicians should base their decisions on people's opinions. I think that after this citizens' debate, elected representatives who are the deciders on a local level or on a national level, and national representatives can get their information from the locals, I think they will be able to do something so that everything that's been said here will reach the top levels of government. And if tomorrow we have to decide whether to accept or refuse GMOs, then this debate will necessarily go to the National Assembly. At that point, I think the representatives will all take into consideration all the opinions, because they're the ones who will decide in the end.
Notre première recommandation. Nous recommandons aux chercheurs de focaliser leur
We recommend that documents resulting from the work at this forum be distributed, that they reach the office of the President of the Republic, the Regional Assembly, farmers' organizations, and even the media. These are our recommendations after 5 days of work. We recommend that researchers focus their research on improving the value of traditional and local seeds, different from GMOs. We recommend that growers be implicated in research. We recommend that those with administrative and political responsibility, as well as growers, get involved in promoting biological agriculture, which is focused on promoting local production.
C'était nos recommandations après ces 5 jours de travaux.
I think that you are forcing us to say with you no to GMOs, yes to local seeds. But it's a debate. We are in a citizens' forum. It's a democratic choice that you had, but we are also in a democratic space. And Mr. Ouattara said it. It is the first time in our region of Africa that this sort of forum on GMOs has taken place. But it's the first time, democratically. I think debates will continue on the subject of GMOs, despite our democratic game. Dear participants, this is a place to thank one more time all our partners for their invaluable contributions to the development of our region. I won't keep you any longer, and I wish a good trip home to all of the participants. I declare closed the talks of this citizen space for democratic deliberations on GMOs and farming in Mali. Thank you.
Avocat du Mangini Kaba, jugé par du Mangini Kaba, donc il a la lune à bas, le bain et pas la poumane. Oulia Kuma Kanimo, ma balia, ma nomme.
If my memory is good, here in Mali, there was a variety of rice that they took away from us. And ever since, we have been dependent on them. This variety did not need fertilizer. Today, they have given us another variety called BJ. You need 10 sacks of fertilizer to harvest 100 sacks of rice. Isn't that a loss for growers? We had better beware of this GMO business. Sure, rich people would like to cultivate GMOs in Mali, but our government can oppose cultivating GMOs in the country. In any case, if they agree to bring in GMOs on account of bribes, that would be a disservice to the country.
I asked the same question in Sikasso. I said that for more than a year, we've been talking only about GMOs. Is there something behind GMOs? I just want to know. The problem is that there are Malians who have money and who want to produce GMOs.
Those who encourage us to produce GMOs are not the consumers. Those people will go get their food somewhere else. So poor people are the ones who will consume GMOs. Poor people will die. So we don't want GMOs in Mali.